Good morning and welcome to Ireland AM. We are here in the Marble City in the River Court Hotel in the heart of Kilkenny. And what a morning we have for you over the next 3 hours. Now, Kilkenny don't do things by half because over the next couple of days, they not only have the St. Patrick's Day celebrations, they also have a Tradfest. And thanks to Real to Real who are here this morning entertaining us, they'll be playing in the Tradfest here in Kilkenny. Now, we also have some sporting stars, Henry Shefflin and Stephanie Roach. They'll be dropping by a little later on also. And Emma Langford is going to be treating us to a performance. Our very own Edward Hayden is going to be showing us how to make some fabulous brown bread. But not only that, he is the Grand Marshal of the parade here in Kilkenny this morning. So there'll be lots of bowing. There's a red carpet and a private dressing room. I'm telling you, there's no messing with Edward this morning because he is the Grand Marshal tomorrow. So that and lots more from Kilkenny right throughout the morning, and we're going to be moving to the parade. We're in the heart of Kilkenny a little later on. So a great show lined up. What's happening back at studio? Beat that.
Alan, it is great to see you there this morning. Look at that. Look at the band. You're going to have a very fun day today.
It was. He was freezing earlier on, giving out. Alan, have you ever been a Grand Marshal in Ballyfermot or anything, Alan?
No, I've never been a Grand Marshal anywhere. I've never been invited.
Lad,
have you
someone.
Been a Grand Marshal in Limerick?
No.
No. They're not that mad.
They're not desperate. They're not desperate. Have you
There's
been...
always time. There's always time.
Do you have the keys of Monaghan? Have you been a Grand Marshal of Monaghan?
No, I haven't. No. Lads. I don't think so. Yeah. Alan, listen, delighted to see you out and about this morning. It's going to be an amazing show.
Yes, it is. A bit of music. So it's going to be fantastic. We've got lots to come here in studio as well.
Yes, coming up later this hour, we're going to get some savvy saving tips from a TikToker who's on a mission to help us stretch our money. We all need that at the moment.
I've become quite obsessed with her on Instagram.
I just watch her all the time.
Money's on the catwalk, stylist Lorna Weightman. She's got clever wardrobe hacks. They're really good that will help you spruce up your silhouette in no time.
Plus, our movie man, Brian Lloyd, reviews the latest film and streaming releases, including the Shazam sequel and the new series of Ted Lasso.
Somehow, Tommy will end up talking about Top Gun Maverick. I don't know how, but he will end up talking about Top Gun Maverick in the movie bit.
And I owe Brian.
Oh, we owe Brian money, actually. Yeah. Right now, it's time to go over to the Virgin Media News Hub. Here is Anne O'Donnell.
Thanks, Mary, and good morning. Well, the Governing Council of the European Central Bank meets today to decide on further interest rate hikes, with expectations that rates may be increased by as much as 0.5%. That is despite ongoing turmoil in the banking sector. Well, shares of Credit Suisse lost more than 20% of their value on Wednesday, hitting a record low after its biggest shareholder, the Saudi National Bank, told news outlets that it would not inject more money into the Swiss bank. It sent shares of other European banks plunging and fanned new fears over the financial sector following the collapse of Silicon Valley Bank and Signature Bank in the US in recent days. The Taoiseach is expected to attend a number of events today on day two of his visit to the US, and it comes as Leo Varadkar has been speaking to Virgin Media News correspondent Gavin Riley on Irish-US relations.
Here in Washington, at least, St. Patrick's Day is not just a day anymore. It is effectively a whole week of festivities. Today is day two of 3 days of festivities and engagements for the Taoiseach, at least. He's been pointing out in a sit-in interview with me last night that there is an awful lot to be said for Ireland's access to the White House and to the senior power brokers on Capitol Hill.
When it comes to those issues, it's not telling him an idea that I'll be doing. It'll be thanking him, because from the very moment he became president, President Biden has been very much across Irish issues and very supportive of the Irish position, first in relation to Brexit, and then more recently being very supportive of the Westminster Protocol, Windsor Protocol, and he was one of the first people to issue a statement about it. So mainly it'll be thanking him for that, also thanking him for his leadership in relation to Ukraine, which is so important to Europe and democracy and freedom around the world, and then also having an opportunity to speak to him about economic relations between the two countries, and about the forthcoming visit, which very much looking forward to.
Ahead of his meeting here with the President of the United States, Joe Biden, at the Oval Office tomorrow, today the Taoiseach has another varied day of engagements. He's having a sit down with the editorial board of the Washington Post to impart Ireland's view of current affairs all around the world, including Ukraine and Northern Ireland. And he's meeting with the Ancient Order of Hibernians, one of the most influential societies in America, who run many of the St. Patrick's Day parades, who once upon a time would not have permitted the likes of Leo Varadkar to take part because of his sexuality. Perhaps that in its own way, a sign of the changing times. Gavin Riley, Virgin Media News, Washington.
Well, back home, a man in his 40s is being questioned in County Kildare after revenue seized over €1.1 million worth of herbal cannabis. The arrest was made after 55 kilograms of the drug were discovered by revenue and the Garda National Drugs and Organised Crime Bureau. Elsewhere, at least 14 people have been killed as a result of torrential rainfall and floods in Turkey. The worst affected areas are two provinces which were left devastated by two major earthquakes last month. Two of the dead were members of a family that had been left homeless by the quake and had been sheltering in a container that was washed away.
Ireland captain Johnny Sexton says he's trying to keep emotion out of his preparations for his final Six Nations match. It comes as teammate Peter O'Mahony has said Sexton changed rugby for the better.
Yeah. Johnny Sexton's final Six Nations press conference, an emotional week for the Ireland captain as he looks to finish his Six Nations career with a grand slam.
In the background, definitely. Special, of course, but you know, it's more about the team this week and getting the best performance that we can out there. You know, I'd never be able to live it yourself if you don't turn up and play well. Like, so that's the focus.
Johnny, we had Peter O'Mahony in here a few minutes ago, and I asked him to sum up what you've done for Ireland in this competition. He said he hadn't got long enough, but he used the words, "you changed rugby." When you hear things like that from teammates like Peter O'Mahony, what does it mean to you personally?
A lot. Like, I'm very good friends with Pete. I played with Pete since the start, really. He came in and can't remember, 11, 12 maybe. Played so many games together. He's a special teammate. So, a lot. I don't think it's true, but look, when someone says something nice, it is nice.
As well as the Grand Slam, Sexton will be looking to secure his place in Six Nations history. This kick against Scotland put him level with Ronan O'Gara as the competition's top point scorer, a record he'll be looking to break this weekend.
Have you heard from Rog since last weekend?
We were talking last week after I got asked about it here. I haven't spoke to him this week. I've had the phone off, people looking for tickets, so he hasn't asked me for tickets yet.
A win on Saturday would be just the ticket for Sexton in Ireland. Bernard O'Toole, Virgin Media Sport.
And you can see Ireland against England live here on Virgin Media 1 on Saturday. Yesterday saw another day of Irish dominance at the Cheltenham Festival. 6-5 favourite Innergameen retained his champion chase crown for jockey Paul Townend and trainer Willie Mullins.
Grenadine, second last for Innergameen. Captain Guinness through the top, back in fourth place, Energy Sheet, then Grenadine, and last of all of those continuing is Edward Stone. Innergameen soars over the last. Captain Guinness in second, Energy Sheet. They are very well strung out. Nube Negra has been pulled up, but Innergameen, all the rage in the market, never a moment's doubt. Back to back, Betway Queen Mother champion chases. Innergameen for Paul Townend and Willie Mullins again salutes the crowd.
And our live coverage from Cheltenham continues today at 1 on Virgin Media 1. That's your sport for now. Here is Derek now with your weather.
For car insurance, van insurance or home insurance, call the Quote Devil. Unless, of course, you've got money to burn.
Throughout the morning, there'll be widespread outbreaks of moderate to heavy rain with a risk of flooding in some areas and highest temperatures of 12 to 15 degrees. The widespread rain then across Ireland will continue into the afternoon, turning showery. Later, some drier spells will begin to emerge between showery spells with temperatures of 13 to 15 degrees. And tonight, showers will continue mainly in the south while the remainder of Ireland will stay dry. Later, more persistent rain will spread into the west, once more becoming widespread by morning and minimum temperatures of 7 to 10 degrees. And that's your weather outlook.
For first-time drivers, young drivers, returning drivers, if you've had an open claim or have had too many penalty points. The Quote Devil's always got one hell of a quote.
Well, it's looking like it's going to be a dry parade for St. Patrick's Day parade, as the Gardaí confirm a voluntary alcohol ban in the capital until 4 p.m. tomorrow.
Good thing. One would think that one back to Ireland AM. It's time now to take a look at today's paper, starting with the Irish Independent. Its headline: Cuckoos and state snap up 42% of new homes for sale. Cuckoo funds, local authorities and state-backed housing charities have all stepped up their home purchasing activities, tightening the squeeze on first-time buyers.
The Examiner leads with emergency bed shortage as eviction ban ends. Leo Varadkar has said councils are ramping up the provision of emergency accommodation to help those who find themselves homeless after the eviction ban is lifted on March 31st.
Fury over Varadkar, snub to American business, is the top story on the Daily Mail. Taoiseach Leo Varadkar reportedly snubbed high-level executives who invest billions in Ireland by declining to have lunch with them in Washington yesterday.
The Herald's front page reads, St. Patrick's Dry Parade. Off-licences and shops in Dublin city centre will not sell alcohol until 4 p.m. on St. Patrick's Day in a bid to make the celebrations as safe as possible.
The Irish Times with silver to serve up to 30 years in prison for capital murder of Detective Garda Horkin. Stephen Silver, described as having a seething resentment towards the Gardaí, will serve a sentence of up to 30 years following his conviction for the murder of Detective Garda Colum Horkin in Roscommon in June 2020.
The Mirror goes with the same story, justice for Colum. The family of slain Detective Garda Colum Horkin hugged each other in court yesterday as his killer was convicted of capital murder.
The Sun reads, cop killer is guilty.
And finally, the Star's headline is The Best of Us, as tributes have been paid to Detective Colum, Garda Colum Horkin.
Now, Aideen Finnegan from the Irish Times joins us now with more on those stories. Aideen, thank you so much for joining us. Can we just get a rundown of what was going on with Stephen Silver and the case against him?
Yes, so Stephen Silver was found guilty of capital murder. There were three options open to the jury. Capital murder, an ordinary murder charge, which is life, which is about 20 to 25 years, and then on the manslaughter on the basis of diminished responsibility or self-defence. And that was based around the fact that Stephen Silver had been in and out of a psychiatric hospital, over the past 20 years. Mm. 46, he'd had 17 stays, some voluntary, some involuntary. So the jury had to decide whether his history of mental illness had a bearing on what happened that day in Castlereagh in County Roscommon. Psychiatrist for the defence, Dr. Brenda Wright, said his behaviour in his subsequent interviews with Gardaí was bizarre and inappropriate, and her conclusion was that his mental capacity was affected. But Professor Harry Kennedy for the state said that his anger and confrontational behaviour was a product of not his illness, but his personality. So this was a very tricky case for the jury to decide, but after 9 hours, they came back with a unanimous verdict of the capital murder of
And capital murder, that is...
That's 40 years.
40 years, yeah.
And
wow.
It's the most serious form
of the most
homicide.
Serious, and it is 30 years before you can request parole. Okay. So he's 46 now. He'll be 76 at the time he's...
And what happened on that evening in 2020?
Well, there's actually a really great long read in the Irish Times today by Owen Reynolds that goes into this. It's quite a long story, but to summarise it, he was coming back from having spent a night in Dublin with an Australian woman he'd met who was flying back to Australia. This is obviously during COVID. He claimed that there were people in the hotel who were MI6 agents, that there was CCTV footage from checking under his car before he made the trip back west. He had been staying at a Dublin hotel. The prosecution claimed that he had retrofitted this spotting on CCTV to make it look like he was paranoid. But again, so he drove west. He stopped in Castlereagh. He met somebody who showed him a video on his phone of a mutual acquaintance having their house raided by the armed support unit. So this angered Stephen Silver. And he went and met the former acquaintance. Mm. They were hanging around that evening and they were riding a bike in an estate in Castlereagh when locals call Gardaí to respond to that antisocial incident. Mm. And it was at this time that there was a wrestle with Garda Colm Horkin, and unfortunately he was shot 11 times 11 by times. Stephen Silver.
Yeah, and his wife at the back said, my husband was a sick man, but... About Stephen Silver, of course, yeah. Capital murder. Yeah,
and it's obviously
a story for the family of Colm Horkin.
Their chance to be able to speak, because these cases are about who is accused. Mm. And so they were able to kind of talk about how, you know, Marty Horkin, was brother said he was the best of gentlemen, and they got to pay tribute to him after the decision
the best
yesterday.
Of us. Heartbreaking yesterday watching them outside the court. And if you want to read that long read, it's very interesting, the lead up to those events. It is in the Irish Times this morning. Now we're going to move on to a different and just another just really depressing story, and this is false allegations being laid against foreigners as though they're attacking people, and it's completely wrong.
And perhaps even sometimes perceived that people are foreign, and they're not. Actually.
And they're not.
So a woman was arrested, or she has been released without charge now, and a file is on its way to the DPP, and she has been arrested by Gardaí in County Waterford, investigating whether a false allegation was made to them by her about a sexual assault by
foreign nationals.
Yes. So this was taken up by an agitator who goes around to stir up a bit of anti-immigrant sentiment around the country, put it on YouTube, and, you know, it obviously has riled up an awful lot of people who are open to this. Now, separately, you know, this is going on. We obviously don't know what's going on with this woman in this particular case, but the Garda Press Office said that they are acutely aware of a significant volume of misinformation, disinformation and fake news in circulation in relation to public safety. And that is because this far-right narrative is catching hold in some communities that people's public safety, women and children, are at risk from this invasion of refugees.
And it's interesting, Michael D. Higgins is going to make his speech, and he's going to, on St. Patrick's Day, to talk about the growing tide of racism, forced migration, modern-day slavery and poisonous xenophobia as well. Because I couldn't believe reading, so the Gardaí tomorrow on St. Patrick's Day, they're on standby to prevent anti-immigration protesters potentially trying to disrupt the Dublin parade as well.
Yes, I'm not sure how, I think they're on guard for it, shall we say, and they're not sure how seriously or how, you know, big it'll turn out to be. But apparently there is something. I won't even mention where they're alleged to be gathering tomorrow.
But it's a well-known far-right activist who appears to be saying this online. But in recent days, the Gardaí have said, in relation to this anti-immigrant protest, seems to be people don't want to do it. Do you know, people are a bit late. They're like, I don't want to go, hopefully, God willing.
Yes.
By making a false report, you could get a fine up to €500 or actually imprisonment up to 12 months.
Yeah, that's the penalty if you're found guilty of that offence. So we will have to wait and see what happens with that.
We've seen a couple of times as of late as well.
And also just to say that following these, and this isn't the only case of false reporting, there was another one.
No, exactly.
The Gardaí had to take kind of an unprecedented step in Finglas, in Dublin, last month, in saying that, yes, they were investigating a sexual assault on someone, but that the person they were interested in was a white Irish man, not a person of colour or a refugee.
As it had been reported.
As it had been reported.
And vigilante groups are getting together in certain towns in Dungarvan to protect people against this. Anyway, it's just really, really, really depressing.
And St. Patrick's
it'll go off without
dry fault. Parade.
I mean, have we grown as a nation?
Is this a terrible
indictment?
No, but hold on, this isn't new. They've done this before. So
they have.
So what's happening?
So off licences, including in supermarkets, they won't be selling alcohol until 4 p.m.
And this is just in the capital.
Yeah.
So other towns go on off they go.
And publicans are saying, no. We'll be serving. Don't worry. You can come to our public house and drink on the premises.
Yes.
But off licences. So I suppose...
Drink on the streets. Listen, if I want to go to the parade in Dublin with my kids, I don't want to see everybody out drinking.
And there are bylaws
everywhere,
which prevent you from doing this anyway. But obviously, it's just such a big problem.
Yeah, and it's a huge weekend.
Absolutely massive.
Do you know what I mean? And I think all the Gardaí that are available have to be working this weekend and be in Dublin, because they are worried with St. Patrick's Day, with the rugby and everything else that's going on. It is a huge weekend, and to try and cut down on the sales of alcohol until 4 p.m. It's not that
late. Until everyone goes bananas then.
I'm just wondering what you make of this. I know that this is just in one place in Ireland. It is not the first time. It's all over the papers, but it's not the first time that this has happened.
No.
Where they've gone, lads,
that's true.
Just in the city centre, we're just going to close the off-licence until 4 o'clock. What do you make of it? 0896 111 111. I think there's nothing wrong with it. It is a family event.
Yes.
Absolutely.
You know, and it's for families.
I was just doing something quickly with the RSA yesterday and talking about people being safe and mindful because there's going to be a lot of alcohol taken on board, a lot of partying, so just be careful if you do get behind the wheel.
Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely.
I mean,
that's really important.
It is frightening, the
especially
figures.
For this weekend.
Yeah, huge. 40 yeah. people have died on the roads already this year in
wow.
2.5 months.
Shocking.
40 people.
It's
crazy.
Not great. We don't have time to talk about the personal injury claims threatening the future of play centres and playgrounds.
Soft play centres, like public liability insurance, massive problem, and threatening to shut.
They're all going to disappear.
If they disappear, and that, what will that do for children's development?
What will I do with my kids? How am I going to get some peace? I tell you what.
We need them.
I struggle without that.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Well, it's either that or you put them in front of the television.
Well, that's true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So take really? Them out there and socialise and let them play around and beat each other up. Aideen Finnegan from the Irish Times, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Don't beat each other up. Thank you so much, Aideen. Let's check in with Alan in Kilkenny. What's on the way, Al?
Hiya, yes, good morning to you. We're all chatting away here. Goodo. There's lots happening in Kilkenny over the weekend. The Paddy's Day festivities and, of course, Tradfest. And Kieran Cuddihy and Siobhan Donohue will be chatting to us all about that after the break.
Now, Alan is in Kilkenny all morning, soaking up the atmosphere ahead of St. Patrick's Day. Morning, Alan, over to you.
Good morning, Muireann. Yes, we are here in Kilkenny all morning. And it is soaking up the atmosphere ahead of the St. Patrick's festivities starting tomorrow and all over the weekend. And they also have Tradfest. Kilkenny don't do things by half. Here to tell us more about that is Kieran Cuddihy from the Hard Children News Talk and Siobhan Donohue. Good morning to you both. Kieran, proud Kilkenny man.
Yes.
But I have to say, how do you do that commute up to News Talk every day? I was driving down from Virgin yesterday, Virgin Media, and I had to pull in and have a little nap.
Oh, yeah? Did you pull in at my billboard? Did you like it?
Or do you, I saw your billboard.
Yeah, you did.
Up at City West there.
Yes.
Hello, everybody, on your way. If you're passing there, City West, there's Kieran there.
What,
you just 50 feet high.
You get used to it. You kind of have a routine. You try to use the commute a little bit. So we have a production meeting, you know all about them, Alan, and then I get a phone call and talk through the show. And
on the way up in the car.
On the way up in the car. So that takes a good chunk of the drive. And, you know, I don't know, is it a kind of a psychological thing? You've got, like, the certain points in this, revealed too much about myself, where I have, like, little snacks or a little drink and I don't eat them until I get to, like, a certain exit on the road and all of that. But what saves me a
little something when you get to your poster.
Yeah, I guess I give myself a high five at the car window. But as well, you know, you do those little things. And what saves me, I guess, is two things. Is I leave after the traffic. So I leave at about 11:15. The people who commute and are sitting, stop, start, stop, start.
I mean, there are a lot of people that you know in Kilkenny are commuting to
Dublin
because of work.
Strong,
and is it because of
prices
and housing and stuff like that that they stayed in Kilkenny or just, like yourself, proud Kilkenny people and wanted to stay here?
There's a lot of people moving from Dublin back to Kilkenny.
All
and
right.
We have the motorway now, and around the motorway you see loads of cars because people share carpool. So, yeah, it's only an hour and a half up the road.
It's only an hour and a half? Well, that's 3 hours onto your journey every day.
Yeah,
but look at
true.
Yous are doing it, and fair play to yous. Look, we're talking about the festivities here over the weekend. And, like, we talk about St. Patrick's Day, and when Ireland and St. Patrick's Day come together, we think a drink. I know it's a terrible thing that we do. And you've been having some very interesting conversations on the Hard Shoulder recently about the drinking culture in Ireland. Tell us about that.
Yeah, well, it's like the amount of alcohol that we consume in the country, like, is trending downwards and has consistently been trending downwards for a long time. And I know the narrative during COVID is we all started drinking, well, I probably did start drinking a bit more glass of wine during the week and stuff. We all did in the first few weeks and months of it. But even during COVID, the overall level of consumption, like by litres per person in the country, went down. So that continues to happen. The problem we have actually in Ireland is that we consume those litres in little short windows.
Yeah.
So we're binge drinkers. And I guess, look, we're going to see that this weekend.
Yeah.
There's absolutely no escaping it. And I don't want to sound like I'm kind of condoning people going off and engaging in harmful levels of drinking. But at the same time, I think I'd be a little hypocritical if I was very pious about it. I mean, kind of we all
drink
did
sensibly.
It. Drink
is
sensibly.
Drink sensibly. What to do. And they do that because they're all very sensible people in Kilkenny, aren't they, Siobhan?
And you know what? We've got plenty of bacon spuds and cabbage to line the stomach with.
And of course, there'll be lots of events around the city that doesn't involve drink at all.
There is lots.
So tell us about what's happening. So you have the St. Patrick's Day festivities. So, but you just threw a Tradfest in as well. She might as well.
Well, Tradfest is going 10 years, so we're celebrating a big anniversary this year. It's running for a whole week. There's workshops, there's Kaylee's going on. You can be dancing with a sweeping brush tonight if you like, Alan and Kenny.
Okay, I prefer to dance with a person. But
any port in the storm.
We have the Bulmers Tradfail, where there's over 100 unplugged free trad sessions around Kilkenny. So if you're going to come to Kilkenny, we're going to have you hopping and dancing.
So that's on for the full week?
Yeah, that's on. It started on Tuesday and it's going all the way until the 19th. Yeah, so we like to party Kilkenny. Yeah. Like, we're the festival capital of Ireland, aren't we, Kieran?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Because there is loads of stuff coming up. But speaking about the festival, I mean, the parade is huge here now in Kilkenny. Has it always been that big? You obviously went when you were younger. Like us all, we all went to the parade.
Yeah, we did. My dad used to work on Parliament Street, say in the middle of town, and we would go to where he worked and we'd lean out the windows upstairs and look at the parade going by. It all felt huge when I was a kid, but I guess everything feels huge.
There was probably two tractors and about 40 people.
And a few lads in the Defence Forces marching down the road. You know, it's absolutely massive. Like, last year, it was thronged in the middle of town. We lost a kid, actually. We were in the parade and we lost a kid.
You lost your child.
Your kid.
No, not mine, thankfully.
Someone else's child. Yeah. They lost a child. Yeah. But your children are in the parade this year.
They are. They'll be marching with the Hurling Club, Dixborough, all the different clubs. If your kid is involved in any sort of organisation, they'll be asked to march in the parade. You're guaranteed. They'll have their choice of who to march with.
But it's nice to march in the parade. I don't think I've ever marched in a parade in my life.
I didn't march until
I had
kids.
Oh, you could do it this year with our Grand Marshal.
Oh, I tell you, Edward Hayden is the Grand Marshal of the Kilkenny Parade. There's bowing, there's red carpets, there's everything.
You could drive his limo.
I'll be driving his limo around to the parade later on. So the parade is tomorrow.
The parade is tomorrow, but we have pre-parade parties going on. We've got post-parade festivities happening in the castle with Vikings. You can run away with the circus, vintage cars. The parade itself is happening at 1:30, led by the one and only Edward Hayden.
Yeah.
And the whole town is talking about what he's going to wear and what he's going to arrive in.
This is the talking point of Kilkenny, guys. Yeah. Doesn't get better than this, Edward Hayden's going to wear tomorrow.
It'd be like some Central American dictator with a sash and a rose.
No, in fairness, he so deserves this. And we're so proud that he's our Grand Marshal this year. This guy does so much for the city and county with his many, many
hats. A great ambassador for Kilkenny, in fairness to that. He really is. And I mean, so... Like, apart from that tomorrow, then, we're going to be around the parade earlier on. So there's already, I saw it yesterday, there's so much activity going on.
Yeah, we've got the big wheel back in town, the vintage carousel, the market, the festival market. Like, Kilkenny wouldn't be Kilkenny without food going on as well. All the pubs are serving food, as well as Tradfests going on, and music sessions. But we also have Stockton's Wing here in town on St. Patrick's Night. They're back to the 80s, a bit of that. We've got some trad music royalty coming with Emma Langford.
She's going to be performing for us later.
Lisa Lang, our own Reel to Reel is going to be here, the local band that we were on earlier. And we've got Up and Rising Southeast Star Tualua coming as well. So lots to tap and dance
now,
to.
Now, Kumir, is there a special occasion for you as well? Because
it's my birthday.
It's your birthday tomorrow.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to Siobhan. Happy birthday to you. There you go on national television. There you go.
Oh,
look it. And so much like when you were saying Kilkenny's the festival capital, there is the Cat Laughs are coming up, and everyone knows about Cat Laughs. Mm. Lots more stuff coming up over the next couple of months.
Yeah, Arts Week. Well, I don't think we call it Arts Week
Arts
anymore.
Festival.
Arts Festival. Now, it's like the way Shock and the Gaeilge goes on for about 3 weeks as well. We've got Arts Festival. You've got the movie, the subtitled movie festival.
October Bank Holiday weekend.
We're only in March. So I'm talking about October.
But the next one is in June, and that's the Cat Laughs.
Yeah. Which everybody knows, the big one. Yeah. Kieran and Siobhan, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
Let's head back to studio.
Thanks very much, Al.
Looks lovely down there, doesn't it?
Little pastries. See that in front of
you? I know. I wonder if they're going to eat them now. Is that like tuck into the pastries?
Yeah.
Keep an eye on them.
You know what he's like? You might or you mightn't. There's a bit of spice in it, you won't have it at all. Come back to us after the break when we are getting a masterclass in money saving is what we're going to do. We'll
Watch
see you
out
back
for the
here.
The old chili flakes and the old pan au chocolat.
You never know. We'll talk to you soon.
You're very welcome back. Our next guest has over 276,000 followers on Instagram, nearly 200,000 on TikTok, all thanks to her savvy saving tips on everything from investing to finding cheap holiday deals.
I get lost all the time scrolling her Instagrams. Sarah Adekola is joining us now to help us save a pretty penny in 2023. Sarah, it's lovely to have you here. Thank you so much for coming in.
Hi, Sarah.
Because you do so much that is just, it's common sense, but also stuff that I'd never heard of for modern day life. So one thing that I think people will know, that what is it, the 50-30-20 rule.
Yeah. So this is like basically a golden rule for saving and budgeting, and it was created by Elizabeth Warren. So she's a US senator, and basically it looks at your income. So when you get your income after tax, look at how you divide it into needs, wants and savings. So 50% of your income should go towards your needs, so you're like your bills and stuff like that. 30% should go towards your wants, so if you want to travel, and then the 20% should go towards savings. But that also can include investments or clearing off any debt. And I know that's not obviously realistic for everyone with what's happening now, but you can flex that to start building a routine of saving and investing and just managing your money better.
I mean, exactly as you say, different people, different circumstances.
Yeah.
But if you can put something aside, it's so important because we're going into a stage where younger generations, they might not be able to buy that house like their parents.
100%.
And it's harder to invest in things. So if you can put a bit of savings away, it makes a huge difference. Yeah.
And we were one of the countries that during the pandemic, we saved more per capita, I think, than most other countries.
Yeah.
So we know that we can do it.
Yeah.
But even if it's, and I'd say for like children, like from a young age, even a euro.
Yeah.
A week kind of learning.
It's just building the routine.
Learning it.
Building the routine.
Piggy banks and all that sort of stuff. And like, because that kind of leads into the whole cash versus contactless thing as well, that you still encourage people to use cash.
Yeah, I think the best way to curb impulse spending is to pay in cash versus contactless. With contactless, you're just like tap, 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 and literally tapping away everything because you can't see the money going unless you're going onto your online banking and checking. Whereas when you have it in cash, you're seeing the money as you're handing out that 50 euros, that 100 euros, you're like, oh, actually, I've only got 200 euros left. Do I really need that product?
Yeah.
And then it gets you thinking and being more frugal with how you're spending your money. And it's like, okay, maybe I don't need to buy that. I can save that instead.
I couldn't agree more. Honestly,
does it mean they'll have to go to the cash machine to get all the cash?
Like,
and then carrying a pocket full of coins around that stuff as well. I know.
Yeah, just you kind of use it in a way that works for you. But it's funny because a lot of stores now don't want to accept cash.
Yeah.
I think they know exactly what they're doing. Like by not accepting cash, contactless. Again, like you're just spending more.
You'll spend more.
That's the whole point. They want you to spend more. And I guess it's a whole business thing, but you also have to be mindful of that.
So do you carry cash all the time?
Not all the time, but because I don't really spend, to be honest.
Okay.
I'm such a frugal person. That's one thing about me. If I'm spending, I have probably thought about it for like forever, and it has to have really great utility. And I always think, do I really want this or do I just want to be seen with it? Because a lot of the times, especially when it's with expensive products like luxury goods, it's like you don't really want it like that much, but you want that feeling of how everyone's going to view you because, oh, I have a Gucci bag versus the Zara bag, which Zara's amazing. Like, I love them.
Yeah. Look at me, look at me. Well, then what is the 72-hour rule and the three-month rule?
Okay, so the 72-hour rule basically says if you want to purchase anything that's not an essential, wait 72 hours. So for example, if you're looking to buy a couple of stuff on Pretty Little Things, put it in your basket, wait 72 hours. If you don't remember that you want to buy that, it was an impulse buy and you've just saved some money. But if you do remember, a lot of companies have this thing called abandoned cart recovery, and they will drop you a little email with a bit of a discount, and then you get to save some money on that purchase as well.
So if I have stuff in the basket,
it's not always a guaranteed thing, but it's like a sales strategy in order to get you to spend.
Yeah. So they'll send you potential discounts and stuff.
Exactly.
Wow, that's interesting.
A good few online places do that. So they know, their algorithm tells them that this person online, this IP address, has stuff in their cart, they have not bought it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We want to push them to buying it.
That's the whole purpose. Like, while it might seem like a big discount to them, you're spending a lot of money with them. Like, do you know what I mean?
Cart recovery, it's genius.
And because I am a very much an impulsive buyer. Yeah. When I'm just like, I'll buy it. But even the 3 month thing, because you're talking about the Gucci bag. Yeah. Like, that's a big investment, a lot of money. Mm-hmm. You kind of say take 3 months before kind of getting rid of that money.
Yeah, so the 3 month rule, I kind of made it up for myself and now I just share with everyone else. And it's when it's expensive non-essentials, like your luxury products, just wait 3 months. Because the way things are going, everything, they're coming out with new products, new iPhones, and you find yourself 3 months in, oh, now there's a new bag. Now I want that as well. But if you give yourself that time period, you can really decide, do I really want it or do I want to be seen with it? And then if you do buy it, like, okay, there's another product. How do you continue doing that? So it's kind of program your mind to think, okay, I just need to pause and really decide whether this is something that I need to be buying.
A lot of this is about discipline.
That's it.
Like, it is about learning discipline to kind of have stuff like this. But then there's other ways. The abandoned cart recovery is just genius. But also, if you want to go on holidays, there's ways to find the bet that isn't just going on once, checking on a flight tracker or whatever, going, I'm going to get this. There's a way that you can track it yourself.
Yeah, so basically, well, you're tracking it through the Google Flights. So basically, Google Flights, when you want to travel somewhere, so for example, I want to go Dublin to Dubai.
Yeah.
I can switch on the flight tracker. And so it's going to send me an email when the price drops or when the price increases. So I can be more conscious of, okay, the price drops, maybe I'm just going to buy it now because I've just saved some money. Or if the price steadily starts increasing closer to the date that you want to travel, I'm just going to buy it now because otherwise it's going to be more expensive in the future.
So it keeps a track of what's happening for you. And
yeah, exactly. So, like, for example, the example I give there, like, I got an email when the flights for Dubai were 535 euros. And then it sent me another email when it dropped to 497 euros. So I know, okay, I'm going to buy it now because I'm going to save some more money.
Where did this all come from?
Coming from wanting to travel the world and having little to nothing and having to figure out how to do that.
But even you're so frugal. Do you know what I mean? Like, and to even come up with this and to have so many followers online and the content you're putting out is so like, it really, it's catching people's attention.
Yeah.
Like, where did the idea come for this? Have you always been very kind of conscious with your money?
Always. And I think because I grew up in a Nigerian household with my mum looking after two kids on benefits. We didn't really have a lot. So we always had to manage the little that we had. So even at the age of 13, I was working in my aunt's hair salon, like doing braids and stuff like that to make some money on the side. Because my mum obviously couldn't give us like a lot of pocket money or anything like that. I went to university at 19. I had four different streams of incomes, working with Nespresso, drop shipping synthetic wigs, doing hair, was also a brand ambassador. So I always had that. I need to make more, but even as I made more, I became more strict with how I spent my money. I was even more frugal.
Yeah.
Do you get to enjoy it though sometimes?
I do, and that's through the traveling. That's one thing, like, I'm willing to, I always try and save money, but I'm willing to spend more money on, because I think when you travel the world, it opens up your mind and you just become truly a well-rounded person.
Yeah, go and look at what I've gotten instead of buying a handbag. It's really interesting. Sarah Adicola, it is at Millennial Wealth Sarah. Yeah. I really enjoy your videos and they're very practical. If you want to give us some tips as well, 0896-111-111, abandoned cart recovery.
Yeah, or even the 50-30-20 rule. You know, it's really clever, so simple. Okay, coming up on the way in the next hour, we're going to be hearing, heading back to Kilkenny, where Alan is meeting talented singer-songwriter Emma Langford and Kilkenny's finest Edward Hayden, Grand Marshal of the
Grand Marshal.
He's going to be on hand to make the ultimate brown bread.
Plus, here in studio, we get styling tips that will transform your outfits in a flash. Sarah would like them because it will change up the thing. You'll look like two different outfits.
Amazing.
We'll see you back here very soon.
Kilkenny, because we've a jam-packed show for the next 2 hours. A big thank you to Real to Real, who've been performing for us here all morning, and they're taking part in the gig rig tomorrow between 4 and 5 That's part of the St. Patrick's Day Festival. And of course, Tradfest happening here as well over the weekend. Now, Emma Langford is going to be performing and chatting to us in a few moments' time. And, sporting royalty Henry Shefflin and Stephanie Roach is going to be dropping up to us a little later on. But the star of the show this morning is over here because he is the Grand Marshal of the Kilkenny St. Patrick's Day Parade. It's our very own Edward Hayden. Good morning to you,
Good
Edward.
Good morning, Alan. Excitement
for tomorrow.
Great excitement tomorrow. Yeah, I have been bestowed the great honour of being the Grand Marshal of the parade, so I'm kind of easing myself gently into the green this morning and out amongst my people.
Everyone's saying the talking point of Kilkenny is what you're going to be wearing, but we'll chat about that a little later on. What are you going to be making for us this morning?
Well, I'm going to bring you really into the heart of Ireland this morning. I'm going to make some lovely brown bread, and then because I know I have a full family to feed, I have a whole lot of different toppings, so kind of like nice open face sandwiches that people can do before or after the parade tomorrow.
Okay, looking forward to that. And the red carpet has been rolled out. He has his private dressing room. Everything's organised for Edward.
Green now, M&M's only.
Oh, that's it. Let's see what's happening in studio.
Oh, I'm looking forward to that. Can't wait to see what Edward's going to be wearing.
It's going to be amazing.
Thank you very much, Alan. We've loads on the way in studio here too.
Yes, from the new Shazam outing to the latest series of Ted Lasso, Brian Lloyd will be here to give his verdict on the latest movie and streaming releases.
We're going to be crossing over to Cheltenham for the inside track ahead of Friday's Gold Cup.
Wants to win some money. And in fashion, we're showing you clever hacks that will take your wardrobe to the next level with Lorna Weightman. What are we doing this morning, Lorna?
So we're going to show you some really simple tricks on how you can change a look really simply. So even by taking a little belt, you might have a little longer bit in the belt with a dress, and I'm going to show you how to do this very, very simple knot just to make it look more polished.
Hey, presto.
Boom.
Look at that.
I always get that wrong, so thank you for doing that. Now I know I have to do it under. Okay, thank you, Lorna. Cheers.
Thanks very much, Lorna. We'll catch up with you later.
We were talking about what you're doing for Paddy's Day, the drinking ban that's happening in and around Dublin, that
so
is
no
not around the country.
In off licences, shops. The pubs are disputing this. They
no,
want
the
to
pubs
kind of,
are fine.
Yeah, they're okay.
They're open.
But yeah, it's just in Dublin. And basically all the guards are going to be in Dublin to try and cut down on antisocial behaviour because it is, listen, it's a day for the kids. It's a day for the family. It's a day to be celebrated
only
as well.
Only 600 guards in the city centre in Dublin.
Yeah.
It seems like it's a small number. Well, we need a few more.
That's all there is. Suzanne said, every year I bring my children to the local parade, but this year I've decided against it, as last year the town was just full of people spilling out onto the streets drinking. I'll keep them at home and we'll do something ourselves. They're just too young to be exposed to all of that.
And
it's
Olivia,
a shame, isn't it?
Well, Olivia says, I know people always go on about the amount of drink that's drank on St. Patrick's Day, and while that may be the case for some, myself and my family make the most of the day by going into our local village for the parade, and the kids love getting their faces painted. It's great to catch up with all of the neighbours.
Brilliant.
Maybe in
good
bigger parades. I do like a smaller parade.
And the local ones are lovely and you kind of know everyone there, whatever else. I mean, let us know, what are your plans tomorrow? Are you going to go to the big one in Dublin? Are you going to go to local ones? Are you involved in painting the tractor? Like, what are you going to be getting up
and
to?
And what you associate it with, because I'm off kind of, you know... Can I break my Lent tomorrow? I forgot about that.
Well,
you can on St. Patrick's Day.
I know.
You can on say as an
you're
adult.
You're not still going drinking on the streets tomorrow until after 4 o'clock, Maren, okay?
I haven't given that up for Lent. What are you talking about?
I'll read this message out though, because it is a serious one. I've worked St. Patrick's Day for years on the emergency lines, and it's so sad to receive calls from people having what is clearly a drunken domestic while I can hear the children crying in the background. The parades should be about families getting together and the children having fun, and not an excuse for people to get drunk so that they can fight with each other. Off licences being closed until later should be happening nationally and not just Dublin. And listen, I think that it should be a day for the children. It should be a day to enjoy and be proud to be Irish. And, you know, have a few drinks, enjoy yourselves, but it's just gone overboard.
0896 111 111. We'd love to hear from you, what you're getting up to. Shout out to your local parade, breaking the Lent, all that kind of stuff.
Are you the Grand Marshal? Sending what you're going to be wearing?
We're just dead jealous of Edward Hayden, is what we are. It's time for a very quick break now, because after this, we're heading back to where the Grand Marshal of the Kilkenny Parade is, Edward Hayden, where singer-songwriter Emma Langford will be treating us to a tune. We'll see you shortly.
Good morning. It is great to have you back. Now, Alan is in the sunny... It is actually sunny this morning. Sunny southeast.
Where is Kilkenny the southeast?
Well, yeah, it is. Kilkenny Tradfest is underway. Alan, look at the sun. How are you getting on?
Yes. The sun is trying to break through, Tommy. It's trying desperately to break through. Now, our next guest this morning is a folk musician who has longlisted for not one, but two Grammy Awards. And she is performing at Tradfest here tonight in Kilkenny. Singer-songwriter Emma Langford, good morning to you. Now, before we have a chat, we want to listen to and take a look at your song, Everywhere With You. And Emma's singing away here to our own song.
That was actually live.
That's live. Good morning to you. Thank you for joining us this morning. Beautiful song there. Tell us the background of that song.
Yeah, so it was co-written by Derek Ryan and Eleanor McAvoy, who's one of our national treasures.
Yes.
And so Derek's management got in touch with me about recording the song with Derek. Don't know why Eleanor didn't sing it herself, because she's still got such a feckin' gorgeous voice to do it herself. But sure enough,
There's my notes gone now over there.
So I came on board to record remotely from Limerick, and myself and Derek wound up going out to a beach in Doonbeg to record the music video. As anyone can see, it was freezing cold on the morning that we were out there, and but we managed to record something really beautiful.
But you got it done. And it's a beautiful, beautiful song.
Yes.
Now, you are heavily influenced by Irish mythology. And we were chatting before we came on air. And it's a real passion for you now, isn't it?
It is, yeah. It's become basically a self-guided sort of research project. I'm very, very interested in how mythology and lore and history sort of intersect, and where kind of pre-Christian history comes into that, and where the Irish language plays a part in that, and the erasure of it, all that kind of thing. So yeah, it's a big passion and a big focus of mine at the moment, and I'm trying to put those stories into songs and bring them to the people.
To life.
Yeah.
To life. So like at Tradfest tonight then, are you going to be, do you chat about it as well when you're during your set?
I do, yeah. In between each song there's a little spiel, a little story. Some of it is just me rambling and telling stupid jokes, but a lot of it is sort of educational. It's almost a TED talk. So
a good TED talk.
Well, I hope so. People seem to enjoy it so far, and I'm doing okay. Sure, I'm Ireland AM, so I must
be
doing something right.
You must be doing something right. And Shocked in the Gaelic coming to an end now at the moment, but you've also, with the mythology, you're putting some Irish lyrics into your songs as well.
Yeah, it's something I'm very passionate about, is including the Irish language and writing in Irish and celebrating it and letting people in other countries know that we have our own language that's important to us and important to our history and beautiful and worth kind of speaking and knowing. So, yeah.
Now, recently you took part in The Daughters of the Pirate Queen, which obviously part of your mythology, so you, it was something that you obviously delighted to do.
Oh, yeah.
Tell us about that experience. That was for International Women's Day.
It was, yeah. Emer Noon, the award-winning conductor, composer. She's behind the work, the music of Call of Duty and Zelda. She's outstanding. And she got in touch 2021 about being involved in a project to do with women in Irish history. And I straight away jumped on board. And since then, we've had calls over and back. Long Zoom calls and frenzied texts about writing new music around Gráinne Whale, the Pirate Queen. So we did. We wrote new music. I wrote two songs that were on the National Concert Hall stage last week, which was insane, with the National Symphony Orchestra. I was on stage with Wallace Bird, with Nina Hines, Celine Byrne, Aisling McGlynn, Dawn Kenny, all these incredible musicians and singers, and we got to celebrate Ireland's pirating history, which was really great crack.
And obviously with your interest in it, it was fantastic.
Yeah.
I think a musician loves when they're playing with an orchestra, don't they?
Oh, yeah.
Isn't it just something else? It's
it
on
really
a different
is.
Level.
Yeah, it's like the music you hear in your head when you're writing the song is really out there on the stage coming to life, which is, it's a dream come true. And it's not something that when I started out I ever thought I would get a chance to do. And I've had a chance now to work with the RTE Concert Orchestra, with the National Symphony Orchestra. We're looking at taking the show to other countries, other places, and you know, who knows what other mad opportunities will come out of it. So,
well,
yeah.
They certainly will. Now, we were saying in the intro there, longlisted for the Grammys in 2021. I mean, that's a huge achievement.
Yeah, it was cool. It was really cool. It was mad to see myself mentioned in the same breath as a lot of the people who would be mentioned in the Grammys. And chatting to, at the time I was chatting to, name drop here now, but Janice Ian, who's the songwriter of At 17. I had worked
with her on a project she'd done a few months previous during the pandemic, and got in touch with her about the Grammys and just kind of swapping, like talking to her about it and talking to these people who I just never expected to be
but
swapping emails
with. But how does it come about? There'll be people who are singer-songwriters in the country now and they go, how did you get longlisted for a Grammy?
So, it's an arduous paperwork process. It means getting the backing of someone in the States who's involved in the Academy in the first place, who's got a bit of belief in your work, who'll sponsor you to be on the long list, and you need to have a lot of that kind of network sort of stuff done, you know, and that's the reality of this industry. In a lot of ways, it's all about just reaching out to people, being open to things, being sound to people, and hoping for the best.
And you're sound. But the talent has to be there as well now, Emma.
Ideally, it would have to be
now,
there, yeah.
What's coming up next for you? Is it you're going to be working with Polish and French communities in Limerick?
Yes, yeah.
So tell us about that.
So I have been drafted to write new music with a Polish musician for the Polish Arts Festival, which happens every year in Limerick, and I'm very excited about that. So myself and she's a classical singer and a violinist and a writer herself, so we're going to write some new work around women, the intersection of Polish and Irish history and culture, which will be really fun, because we have Samhain, yes, and they have Kupala, which is kind of their own version of sort of this kind of mad bonfire and headdresses and stuff that happens every year. Doesn't happen at the same time, but it's similar in kind of culture, so we'll be working together exploring those links. And then with the French community, the honorary consul Loic Guyon in Limerick has invited me to write work about the intersection of Irish and French history. So that's the next thing now.
Fabulous, yeah. Fabulous. Now, you're going to sing for us The Winding Way Down to Kells. Tell us about the song.
Yeah, The Winding Way Down to Kells Bay is a song about it's dedicated to my granduncle, Emma Langford, who lived in Carrasaveen, in Kells Bay in Carrasaveen. And it was written about the community that he spent most of his life in, and the community that welcomed us into their arms when he passed suddenly in 2018. So the song is, yeah, it's a love song to a place and a people and a man that was very, very loved in the area.
OK, so, well, you're going to sing it for us now. You're going to head over there. And just to let everybody know that Emma will be performing in Clear's Bar and Theatre in Kilkenny tonight, so make sure you get your tickets. And as she said, she's here to perform that beautiful rendition of the song, The Winding Way Down to Kells Bay. So, Emma, in your own time, take it away.
Thank you. There's a saint on the hillside at Yachtyaspiakbui, on the winding way down to Kells Bay. Lena's chocolate, the story in August, licked the ski on the winding way down to Kells Bay. And when the bell rings, then we'll all head away on the winding way down to Kells Bay, where the ocean could carry our worries away on the winding way down to Kells Bay. And we'll stop for the chat and the owl cobonte on the winding way down to Kells Bay. And the golden sunset like no other, they say, on the winding way down to Kells Bay. Yes, the ocean could carry our worries away on the winding way down.
Why we all go hungry here this morning, I'm having to cook my own dinner and all we've got is a load of oil. Alan has managed to persuade a familiar face to feed him in Kilkenny instead. Alan, I am not impressed.
Tommy, sorry, no food for you this morning because we are here in Kilkenny, and of course, if you're in Kilkenny, you have to have the star of the show, Edward Hayden, Grand Marshal of the Kilkenny Parade tomorrow. Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's
so
a nice
much,
honour.
Alan. Yeah, listen, it is a lovely honour. All joking aside, it is lovely. I kind of didn't really think of it. And when they asked me, I mean, I suppose I've spent a lot of time, I would always name check Kilkenny anywhere I am to try to extol the virtues of it. I know we have you converted now as well to the wonder of Kilkenny. But yeah, it was a lovely honour to be asked. Now that it's approaching, I feel a bit awkward about it. You know, I'm afraid I'm going to... Well, listen, I'm coming down the street
I saw the car yesterday.
Impressive.
I saw the car. So we were in the Pembroke last night and I saw the car.
I'm afraid that I'm going to feel like a pig in a Delft shop or something. But anyway, all will be well. I'm going to be out amongst my people and really looking
forward
to it.
Come here, what's the locals in Craignamana think now that you're snubbing them?
Well, I've abdicated all responsibility. We have a wonderful parade in Craignamana as well, and that's taking place at 11:30. So,
you can do both.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, you're making some brown bread here this morning.
I'm giving you a full
us.
Blast of Ireland this morning. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a gorgeous brown bread. You know, tomorrow is going to be a funny day, and different households have different traditions.
Yeah.
People might be going to parades, they might be having a little small spahan somewhere along the line as well.
It is a day where it's not the usual.
It's not the usual. So, I said maybe people might be going to do some lovely sandwiches. So, I'm doing some open face sandwiches this morning. So, what I've got is I've got some lovely brown bread. Now, brown bread is one of those things that's so unique to different people's houses. So I've got some lovely coarse wholemeal flour.
Do you have your own recipe for brown bread? Because I know Catherine Layden does.
I have my own recipe and I do it all the time. Maybe a few different alterations or iterations of it, but the core is the same. So into my lovely bowl here, I'm going to put some coarse wholemeal flour. So I have 350 grams, 10 or 12 ounces of that. Then I've got some flour. I've got some plain flour and I'm going to put some bread soda in there as well. So I'm going to just put 2 teaspoons of bread soda and I'm going to put a little bit of salt in there as well. I'm just going to say in the absence of a teaspoon.
You tried to find there.
In granny's china. Now, in there, I'm going to put some bread soda. Now, always be very mean with bread soda. And what I do in the absence of a sieve, just put it into your hand and just
give it a little
rub.
Is that because you forgot the sieve?
No. It was either do me hair or pack the sieve. So I did me hair. Now, in there, we've got the flour, the bread soda, and I'm going to put in some salt in there. I've also got some porridge, so 2 ounces, 50 grams of porridge going in there as well.
Now, would that normally go in, or is that your recipe?
I always put in
this
a bit
is
of
your
porridge,
bit.
Because what it does is it gives that bit of extra coarseness to the bread. Okay. Now, Alan, give that a nice little mix around there, just like so. Or, you know, what you might decide, people might kind of do their hand like a claw and just kind of give it a little rub around, just to make sure that it's nicely mixed through.
Yeah.
Okay. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to pop in some liquids. Now, this is one of the things that not everybody puts into bread. I put 2 eggs into my brown bread. The reason I do is it just makes it kind of almost cake-like.
So
okay.
People wouldn't necessarily do
not
this.
Not always.
Okay.
People would just sometimes just use the buttermilk. We've got this lovely product as well. This is a Kilkenny-based product. It's Highbank Orchard. They do the apple syrup, but they also do a wonderful treacle as well. So I'm just going to put a little bit of treacle in there into that. Okay, so that's really nice. And what that does is it darkens it. Now, tomorrow people might be putting a little bit of stout or something into their bread as well, which they could do.
Could you put stout in it?
You could, of course, stout, a mixture of stout and buttermilk. The treacle is just nice, about a spoon of that in there as well. And then, of course, I've got my lovely buttermilk. I'm going to pop in the buttermilk in there. Now, Alan, in terms of consistency, what I'm going to put in is just shy of 500 millilitres, and I'm looking for a consistency that's not dissimilar to that of a cooked porridge, okay?
Okay.
So I've said to people in the recipe, if they're looking at the recipe online, I've said to people that it's a kind of a wet, sticky, sloppy consistency. So that's the best culinary term
to describe it. That's a very culinary term. Yeah, wet, sticky and sloppy.
Yeah, well, it's very indicative of what it is that you're looking for. And it just gives people a kind of a benchmark of where they're going. Now, there we have it just like so. Now, you could put in another little bit of treacle into that if you wanted. Just out in the cold, it's difficult to coax it out of the bottle. But a little bit of treacle will darken that.
We have to tell you, lads.
Tis hardy this morning.
It's hardy this morning. Yeah. Hardy people in Kilkenny.
Now, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to put that into my tin. So I've got my 2-pound loaf tin, 900 gram, and I'm just going to spoon that into the tin just like so.
How long would that take now?
Now, interesting that you asked that, Alan, because just before I pop that into the oven, I'm going to embellish it with a few porridge, bits of porridge on the top, some porridge oats, and into the oven, 170.
So this is our magic oven.
Yeah.
We have a magic... We have have a magic oven under here.
Yeah, absolutely. And pull it out of the oven.
Wait till you see this coming out of the oven now. There we go. Look at this out of our magic oven.
You'll get diamonds on your legs with the oven in front of you.
There's our magic oven now, in Kilkenny this morning.
What I've got
so
is,
you put the seeds on top of it
there.
Yeah,
put the things, the porridge oats on top.
170.
Now, Alan, that's a much lower temperature than proficient brown bread bakers will be familiar with baking their brown bread at, because it is such a wet, sloppy mixture. You want to make sure that it dries out really well.
So how long?
So don't. An hour in the oven at 170. After the hour, take it out of the tin, turn it upside down and put it back in for an additional 15 minutes.
Oh, really?
And
if you, you turn it upside down, put it back in?
Yeah. And if you just listen to that, we've got the lovely,
the
nice,
hollow
sharp
sound.
Top.
Yeah.
I've sliced some of that here, and you can see it's, that's what I'm saying, it's that gorgeous, spongy, cake-like bread, and it's really nice. I've got some lovely butter.
And you've made some lovely toppings.
I've made some lovely sandwiches. Now, they're after getting attacked by the tablecloth, so they're a bit Trina Kayla at the minute. But what I've got some lovely corned beef, I've got some ham, and my friend Bride made me some lovely carrot and almond chutney. So that's really nice. I've got chicken with pesto, and I've also got my chili jam with the ham, and then I've got some lovely smoked salmon and some of the Goat's Bridge trout just from our neighbours out the road in Thomastown.
And look at that. If you are heading to the parades tomorrow anywhere, it's lovely to come back and that's all ready.
And a scalding pot of tea.
And a scalding pot of tea because you'll need it. Well, listen, what time does the parade kick off?
The parade kicks off at 1:30 tomorrow, and everyone listening and watching, put out the Child of Prague tonight. The Headless Child of Prague, I believe, is more successful. So put out Child of Prague to pray for no rain. But really looking forward to it tomorrow. And
well, congratulations. We're delighted that you are the Grand Marshal at the Kilkenny Parade. And remember, support your local parades right across the country tomorrow. Get out and support them, because I heard lots of them being cancelled this year because of funds and things like that. So it's great that Kilkenny's still thriving.
And they're
with
back
the
in their fullest sense. Yeah. Last year it was a kind of, you know, a partial comeback. Yeah. So back in their fullest sense this year. So
well, look, congratulations.
Biggie Lynn.
Yeah, congratulations on that. And back to studio.
Oh, thanks very much, Alan. Look at that brown bread. I'm stuck with it in a bullock porridge.
Look at him. He's all,
said
he
no
asked earlier on, will I go get sausage sandwiches? And everyone said no, so he didn't go and get one. Oh, he's so sad. You all right?
Go on, off you go.
All right, treacle. I loved when he said treacle. Treacle's a great word. Now, come here to me. After the break, Lorna Weightman, how are you? Lorna's here.
Good.
You're going to be showing us secret styling tricks that will elevate an outfit,
exactly.
right?
Exactly. Or completely change the silhouette of something. So you'll see in the back of Vanessa here, she's got this little tail that I've made at the back of her T-shirt.
Yeah, a rat's tail.
Little tail. But I'm going to finish this off, and it's actually to show you how you can change an oversized T-shirt to make it look more fitted to go with crop jackets, blazers, some really kind of capsule pieces that you have in your wardrobe. And it's really simple things that you can do at home yourself to change your look.
Great little hacks. Love the go-go and the thing like that. So we'll be doing that very shortly right here on Ireland AM. Hello, welcome back to Ireland AM. And this morning it's all about fashion hacks to create a more tailored and fitted look without spending a cent. Stylist Lorna Weightman is revealing all. Lorna, it's lovely to have you here.
Thank you.
As I enjoy these videos to be... Do this, you have one thing, you can make it look a different way.
Exactly. And social media, especially TikTok,
right.
has been the driver of all of this.
Okay.
And you can actually go down a bit of a rabbit hole with them, because then you could spend hours, like I do, looking for these different ideas, but also the ones that are very practical and easy to do.
Okay.
Some of them will take a little bit of practice. So what I suggest, if there's one that you really like the look of, you need to be looking in a mirror at home. Plenty of practice. Stop and start the video over and over again until you get it. But it's revolutionary.
It's how to get the perfect bow in the trench coats. That one is a tough one. Now, before Vanessa comes out, we're going to look at the one that we all know. This is from Tan France, Queer Eye.
Yeah.
This was the French tuck. I think we've got a video of this one that we can look at. I think most people kind of know this one now, right?
Yeah, and it's a very simple one as well, because it essentially is just a very neat tuck of your blouse or your T-shirt into your jeans.
Yeah.
That's essentially all it is. And what it does actually is it does kind of elongate the lower half of your body a little bit and create a little bit more shape. But we're going to take it to a different level this morning.
Okay, this is the bobbin. Well, you call it bobbin, I call it a go-go.
A go-go, yes. Bobbin. So the handy thing you use for your hair can be also used to create a really nice finish on this. So this is one I made earlier.
Well done. Yeah.
So what you have is you are going to fit the T-shirt to your body, let it sit at the top of your trousers or your skirt, and pull all the fabric to the back. You take your bobbin and you wrap it around as if you're actually doing a ponytail.
Yeah,
That's the easiest thing. But this is, you're not going to be left with this. What you'll do is you will tuck it up and under, and just fix it down so it has a lovely finish on the back. It's that simple.
Yeah.
And then Vanessa's going to turn around now and you'll just see how it just finishes.
It just sits.
Exactly. And this is quite an oversized t-shirt that would hang quite long and quite straight along your body. And it works really well if you've got a tailored jacket or a blazer. So Vanessa's going to put on her crop jacket now, so you can just see how the t-shirt finishes where the jacket finishes. And then the outfit looks a little bit more complete, which I okay. love. And you can imagine if the t-shirt was longer, it would all be out of disproportion.
So we create
this really lovely silhouette, and it's just a hair bobbin and a t-shirt. And this whole look is from Friday's edit and it's available online. And for the t-shirt, you need a good quality stiff cotton because it will hold its shape. And one thing I do get asked a lot is like, well, when I take the bobbin out, is it just going to wreck the t-shirt? Wash it again, it'll fall out. It is nothing that an iron can't take out.
Yeah, it doesn't stretch. It doesn't stretch.
It doesn't. Because when you're tying the bobbin at the back, you're not tying it as tight as a ponytail.
Yeah.
You're giving it maybe one or two loops around just to hold it in place. And that's it,
and
really.
And then it's the tuck up.
That's the tuck up. So beautiful. The first thing you do is you look in the mirror, you tuck the t-shirt up, take it to the back, tie the bobbin, tuck it under, put your jacket on, you're done.
Lovely.
Very simple.
And that sort of boucle vibe with that jacket that was going
it
on
works.
There as well.
Yeah, that's and lovely. That's actually a little bit of a trend in itself because blue was such a big thing at
lovely.
The moment as well.
Let's look at that. This is the, we're going to look at the shirt tie trick to create a more fitted. This is the shirt one. Let's take a look at this.
This is the shirt one. So you'll notice this is about crossing over an oversized shirt. So you can have like a bit of a bigger shirt, even a man's shirt actually would work really well on this as well. And you'll notice that the shirt might be like quite long, a little boxy. How do you make it work? But also if you've got a shirt, if you wanted to wear it out, it works great with skinny jeans and leggings.
Okay.
But if you wanted to vary up your styling with it and wear it with something with a bit more volume on the bottom,
okay.
you want the shirt to look a bit more tailored. So we've done
here.
A little bit of homework first, right? So what we've done is we take the end of the shirt tail, you roll it up, and then you cross it diagonally down into
okay.
your jeans. So we'll do the same thing on the other side here. And actually the pattern here, you'll see where I've been practicing this before I came out there as well.
Kelly's so, like, I've been manhandled all morning
has.
By Lorna Weightman.
So we're gonna tuck it under, and you'll be left here just with the little shirt tail just here.
Yeah.
You're gonna roll it. So you see it finishes just here. And then we're just gonna tuck it down into Kelly's jeans there. And then you're just gonna give it a little finish. So you see it ends with just a little knot, just above the jeans. And you can just pull it out a little bit so it looks a little bit more finished. Then you can tuck the shirt in around the back and it creates a bit more
shape.
Will
it stay?
It will stay
it. Okay.
Because if the shirt is long enough, you've got plenty of fabric to fit down in your jeans. It works really well with high-waisted trousers because they come up a little bit higher around your hip bones,
okay.
up to your rib cage, so it'll keep all of that fabric in shape.
Where's this whole look from? Those jeans
this
are great.
This is all from Penneys and it's all in store now. And I actually, what I love about this shirt is the detailing on it. So you've got that Broadway anglaise kind of effect on it,
yes.
which is very, very pretty and very summery. But another thing that works really well with this shirt is it's kind of a beach cover up as well, so you can do the same trick over your swimwear. It's very pool vibes
that
as well.
That is a great look. I love
Isn't
that.
It?
Thank you so much, Kelly. That is fantastic. We're going to move on to our third one now. Let's take a look at the trench coat belt
so,
trick.
Exactly. This one is really tricky, actually, but I think it has a very powerful effect.
This is the one I'm always trying to do.
Exactly. So for this one, if you've got a trench coat or even just a coat that has a belt tie, if it's a little bit big, a little bit oversized, or you just want to show off what you're wearing underneath, this is the belt
Let's
tie
get
to go for.
Straight into it with Jessica
Straight
here.
Into it. So here is just one I did a little bit earlier, so you can see on this side.
Yeah.
So it's just that little knot here, and what it does is it separates the fabric along the back.
Yeah.
So, but it still creates a bit of tension and shape. So I'm just going to turn Jessica just a little bit this way so you can see. So you've got the belt tie here, and you bring it down and just up. So you've created this kind of loop just here.
Oh,
very,
yeah,
very
okay.
simple. Then you take the end and you bring it down to create a knot. And what that does is you'll see as you tighten it, it creates just a little bit of tension just here. So it pulls the fabric just along your waist. So what that does when you turn around, Jessica, it holds the jacket slightly open so you can see all of your outfit
yeah,
underneath it.
Yeah, yours stayed flat. I really like mine always turns. Where is this whole look from?
This whole look is also from Penneys and it's actually from the Edit collection, which is really lovely. It's all about minimal kind of styling, but also this kind of trench coat as well, it works really well because the trench coat isn't too stiff a fabric, so the belt is really kind of malleable as well,
that
which looks really gorgeous.
Gorgeous.
Isn't
that is
it?
So nice. Thank you so much, Jessica. We're going to look at the belt trick now here. This is one you'll definitely have seen.
So this one is actually easier to do than you might think. And it's just about the trick of going under the belt.
It's under. I was
under the belt, not over. And it works really well if you've got a belt that has too long a strip at the end.
Yeah.
Or if you want to wear it like I have it styled today with a dress and there's nowhere to put the belt end, which I really particularly like. So you might hear you've got the belt on here and you'll notice we've got this like end bit here.
Yeah.
There's nowhere to put it to finish it. So what you want to do is we're going to turn the belt outwards.
Outwards.
Right? So it goes up and under, very similar to the trench. So if you get the trench one right, you'll get this one right. And then what you're gonna do is bring that down in here and you just create this really pretty little knot.
I know it's super simple, but I always get that stuff wrong. So it's go down outwards, okay.
It's actually just about standing in front of the mirror and practicing them a few times and then they just become second nature. But this is one that's been around for quite a while. It's
yeah,
a very simple
it has.
Thing. But if you want to accessorize your dress or you just want to make your belt look a little bit more finished, this is a really easy trick.
And the dress is from
The dress is from My Kind of Dress. It's also a great one for putting a belt with because it does have an elasticated waist on it. So you get that natural cinch so the belt sits really naturally down along the body as well. So it's a great one.
Lovely. Lorna, thanks for the tricks.
Oh, my pleasure.
Imagine TikTok was her homework. Isn't that always nice? Lorna Weightman there. Let's go over. Tommy, what's coming up at the final hour of the show?
That was pretty impressive, Lorna. Well done.
I really
learned
them.
Something there. Loads on the way. We're going to cross live to Cheltenham to hear about today's feature race. Brian Lloyd gives us his take on the latest cinema release and streaming releases, plus Alan chats to the Cats hurling legend Henry Shefflin, and we're going to have a performance of an Irish classic ahead of St. Patrick's Day. We'll see you back here very shortly.
Good morning and welcome to Ireland AM. We are live here in Kilkenny and we've had a great morning so far and we've moved location. We are now on the parade because Edward Hayden insisted he wanted to go on the carousel, which is here in the middle of the town. And I said, we've had a great morning. Loads of people have turned up. Even the Lord Mayor has turned up for us this morning. Good morning to you, Lord Mayor, on the carousel. Great crowds here and great activity here this morning. Now, still to come, we're going to be chatting to Henry Shefflin and Stephanie Roach, and we're going to get a little golfing and putting challenge in. And also we're going to be talking to and having a performance from Kilkenny native and TikTok sensation Robert Grace is going to, as I said, stopping by a little later on. If you are in Kilkenny, come down and say hello because we are here. The castle's just behind us. We are here at the parade. Good morning to you all. How are we? You can come down and join us on the carousel.
You're look like at the king of Kilkenny.
Oh, king of Kilkenny. I is jealous, guys, back in studio.
Cheltenham. From 1 o'clock today, it's just Alan Hughes and Edward Hayden going around and around in a carousel, betting who's going to win.
The poor mayor has just turned up for a nice little photo call and he's been thrown up onto the carousel and does not look like he wants to be there. But anyway, listen, that's a bit of crack. Fair play to you, Alan. All going on in Kilkenny this morning. Now from movies
better
to music.
Better than Cheltenham.
To sporting legends, we're going to have loads on the way for you.
We've also got Brian Lloyd with us this morning. Brian, we've got yet another superhero movie coming out this week. This is a DC one. It's Shazam, Fury of the Gods. Are we in danger of getting superhero fatigue?
We have gone way past superhero fatigue at this stage, in fairness. But Shazam, Fury of the Gods. Do have something else for you, though. The best romantic comedy of the year is out. Yep, is out in cinemas this weekend. Rye Lane, I'm going to be talking about that. I'm going to be talking about season 3 of Ted Lasso. So, yeah, lots to watch.
Oh, it's lots to discuss.
A good romantic comedy.
We'll move on from the superheroes and move on to the good stuff.
Well, I am just so jealous.
We're looking at the papers.
We're looking at the papers because it's another great day for the Irish at Cheltenham. They're absolutely storming at the minute. But it was a day for that one young Irishman we'll never forget. Will Dalton from Virgin Media joins us now. Will, it was a super story from yesterday's race.
Yeah, Tommy, it was another incredible finish to another incredible day for the Irish. Real strong contingent did excellent. We'll talk about that in a few minutes. But we have to talk about young John Gleeson, the 18-year-old from Waterford. His first ever race at Cheltenham. He's only just done his mocks. He's doing the leave insert in the summer. Turns up in the champion bumper on a horse owned by JP McManus. Was actually bred by his own family before being sold to JP. And he romped home to take his first win in his first race at Cheltenham. A day he's never, ever going to forget. Let's talk more about this now. I've got former jockey with me, Lisa O'Neill, who's with the Gordon Elliott stable. So what do you say about that yesterday? 18 years old, not even done your leaving, and you're winning a Cheltenham.
Oh, it's just fantastic. I think it's so well named as well, A Dream to Share. And a dream was definitely shared here yesterday with John Kiley. I think he's 84, 85 years of age, having his Cheltenham Festival winner, and his wife, Marion, who was here as well to celebrate it. And obviously John Gleeson, he's so young, his first ride at Cheltenham. I seen him yesterday morning. I think he was getting some advice from Tony McCoy as well. So he definitely advised him well, but gave it a fantastic ride. And I know his mother, his sister and his father, Brian, were all here to celebrate it with them, and I can imagine the dream is still going to be alive for a long, long time ahead. But to have your first winner at Cheltenham on your first ride, it's just absolutely fantastic. He's got a bright future ahead of him.
It certainly has, and it looks like it's been a bright week for the Irish, and that's going to continue today. We'll talk about yesterday, Willie Mullins, a good few winners, and Gordon Elliott, a great win for Delta Work as well.
Yeah, brilliant for Delta Work and Keith Donohue. He obviously had such an association with Tiger Roll over the cross-country obstacles in the previous years, but to get off the mark with Delta Work yesterday was brilliant. Himself and Galvin fought out the finish. It was a replica of Delta Work and Tiger Roll last year, but great for Keith, great for Gigginstown as well. Michael O'Leary and his wife Anisha were there to celebrate it, and brilliant for Gordon. His horses are running great this week, and hopefully there's some more winners to come.
Must be 10 Irish winners so far. What are you expecting today with the Ryanair Chase, the Stayers Hurdles, the big one?
Yeah, the Stayers Hurl. Gordon actually has a couple of horses for that. Tiap, who's actually favourite. I rode him out this morning. He's in great form. He looks $1 million, and the ground's really turned to suit him as well. So fingers crossed for him. Obviously, he's up against some strong opposition. Charles Burns has Blazing Cal in there as well, and I've seen him. He looks fit and ready to rock this morning. So fingers crossed it's going to go the way of the Irish.
I hope so. It's been the way of the Irish all week. Ryanair Chase at 2:50 and the Stayers Hurdle at 3:30. They're the feature races today, and of course, they're on Virgin Media One.
Absolutely. Thanks very much, Will. Great to chat to you as well. I'm looking forward to the Ryanair Chase. It's always a classic as well. I can't believe that 18 years of age, John Gleeson.
I just love that he said, this was after he won yesterday, he was like, I have the pre-exams over and it's coming up to Easter, so I got the time off easy from school. It's just
and goes
brilliant.
And wins a race in Cheltenham, coming up that straight. It just must be the adrenaline rush that you must get from that at that age as well. Class. Congratulations to you. And of course to the trainer, John Kiley, veteran as well.
Yeah, 86 in May, so amazing story all around. Now it's time for a very quick break after this, from superhero sequels to comforting comedies. We round up what's worth watching this weekend. We'll see you in a few minutes.
Right, it's time to chat all things in the world of TV and film, with plenty of new releases hitting our screens.
Brian Lloyd is here with what to watch this weekend. Brian,
hey.
It's a pleasure to have you here.
Hey, right,
we're going to go superhero film.
Yeah.
Now, this isn't a Marvel, it is a DC, and it's a sequel to Shazam. It's called Shazam Fury of the Gods.
Yeah.
What's it about?
Right, so Shazam is Billy Batson. He is played by Zachary Levi and Asher Angel, and the whole thing about it is that he's actually a teenager, but when he says the word Shazam, he turns into this high-powered superhero, and his whole family of adopted kids. Tommy, I can just see the eyes just glazing over.
So it's, you know, big what? With superheroes.
Let's take a look. Shazam.
The wizard gave me superpowers.
Shazam!
And then everybody got superpowers.
Started from the bottom, now we're here.
All right, here's the situation.
Started from the bottom, now the whole team here.
The Daughters of Atlas are coming to hunt us.
Children stole the power of the gods.
Shazam!
Ripped it from our father's core.
Okay, I feel like maybe I should be writing all this down.
Okay, so Lucy Liu is in this one along with Helen Mirren.
Yeah. And she's brilliant. Helen Mirren is actually really, really funny.
I love Helen
And like the thing of it is she actually kind of understands the assignment, which is, as you saw there, it's not taking itself seriously.
No.
This isn't Batman Begins. I mean, if you're looking for something like really realistic and dark, this isn't it.
The thing was with the first one, that's what I liked about Shazam.
Yeah.
DC going, oh, actually, let's have a bit of fun.
Yeah, actually, you know, not everything has to be so super serious
yeah.
and sad and, you know, like the way the kind of Superman was.
Yes,
like, and, you know.
Exactly.
So it is. It was very much kind of done as a reaction. But now the fact that they're kind of, you know, reinventing the whole DC universe again, because, of course, they are. Shazam is kind of like, I don't know, the redheaded stepchild. Like, no one really knows what to do with it anymore. And it's kind of, what? That's a thing. That's a thing.
So
that's a phrase.
So
don't look at me like that. But anyways, it's the odd one out. There you go.
Okay.
Is that a little bit better?
What do you give it?
3 out of 5. It's actually not that bad. It's okay. It'll pass the time. I think if you have, like, younger kids or whatever and you want to bring them to the cinema over the weekend, this is what
something
to
do that.
My little fella loves superheroes.
There you go. He'd love that.
Who actually would love that.
Yeah.
Okay, let's move on to Rylane, because
yeah.
you big this one up?
This one is honestly the best romantic comedy I've seen this year and probably will be the best romantic comedy this year.
What was the best you saw last year then?
Ticket to Paradise.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah,
Ticket to Paradise
so enjoyable.
Was last year.
So it's up there with this then.
Better than Ticket to Paradise.
Julia Roberts was Ticket to Paradise. Yeah,
yeah, but it's better than Ticket to Paradise. Oh, it's way better than Ticket to Paradise.
What's this about?
This is just your standard meet cute story. So Yaz and Dom are these two people who are living in South London. Dom has just recently broken up with his girlfriend, bit of kind of traumatic. Yaz also has broken up with her boyfriend. Two of them meet on a day in Rye Market, which is in like Brixton, and they just kind of walk around London, kind of getting to know each other. She then decides that she wants to break into her ex-boyfriend's apartment to get back this vinyl that has been there the whole time. So it's them trying to come up with a plan to get in there.
Okay, let's take a look at Rye.
It's Dom, right? I'm Yaz.
That's me. Gonna meet my ex for the first time since the breakup.
And you're still calling it the breakup.
I thought we were fine. We were better than fine. We moved in together, but we had Hamilton tickets.
It's a serious commitment.
Right?
So, what happened?
She cheated on me with my best friend.
You cheated on Dom? With him?
Oh, that hurts a little bit.
I mean, I get it. The arms are nice, but what did she even talk about?
Are you just going to sit there and say that to me?
Well, she said my arms are nice.
Okay.
It actually is funny. This is the thing. Like, it's a thing of it that, like, it's actually very, very funny and very, very sweet and very, very smart as well because, you know, like, it's 82 minutes long, so they really kind of have to try compact. Yeah, I know, 82 minutes.
Love that.
Right away, that's already, you're already winning there. But, yeah, I mean, kind of like, yeah, Before Sunrise or whatever, it does sort of just amble along a little bit.
It's got those vibes of just Judy Depp and Ethan Hawke wandering around Paris.
But actually, where Before Sunrise was kind of like sweet and romantic, this is actually very, very funny. Like, they actually do have great chemistry together. I mean, that's the thing about comedies like this, is that there's something really good about watching charming people flirt with each other. You know that kind of way? I love watching people flirt. Like,
and it's snappy.
And exactly, that's it. At 82 minutes, like, there's no fat in this whatsoever. They are just blasting right through it. Like, but it doesn't feel like it's kind of rushing, you know, that sort of way. Like, I mean, by the end of this, my face was sore from smiling so much at it.
Oh, wow, OK.
I loved it.
And first-time feature director as well.
Yeah, Rain Miller, yeah. And like I said, like, she worked on, like, music videos and that kind of shows as well, because you can tell that she has a real good sense of, like, pacing and editing, and the soundtrack is great as well, and they all look great as well. If for people who are saying, like, you know, romantic comedies are only just on Netflix or Prime Video and they're generally crap, this is the film. Go see this, because if you don't go see this, then they won't keep putting them into cinemas. So you have to go see these. Couldn't agree with you.
Oh, yeah, more. It's out this weekend.
And worth it.
Absolutely worth it. This is like the best. This is the best film this week. This is the best romantic comedy I've seen this year. Probably will be the best romantic comedy I've seen this year.
How many out of five?
4.5 out of 5.
Oh, I'm gone.
It's really,
cinema.
Really good. It's so good. Please go see it.
Let's talk about.
Yeah, I love that.
Yeah, we have to encourage people to go to the cinema, like you and your member.
On my own. Top Gun Maverick. Yeah.
There we go.
Yeah.
I knew we'd get it in.
It saved cinema.
It did. Yeah. He's right.
Let's talk about the X series. This is a slasher film from 2 years ago.
Last year,
right? Starring Mia Goth.
Yeah.
There is a sequel that is a prequel, right?
Yes.
Tell us. Okay.
So it's called Pearl. Okay. It is set in 1918. It is a prequel to X. You don't have to have seen X to kind of get what's going on here. Essentially, what's happening is Mia Goth's character is this young woman who's living in rural Texas in 1918 during the influenza pandemic, living a very kind of hard life in this rural thing. Her father he's invalided essentially, and the mother is this very kind of harsh, domineering mother. Yeah. She wants to get out of her kind of boring life, and when a chorus... It's a horror film. It's a horror film.
Okay.
And you kind of set it up and you think it's this sort of like kooky, weird, psychological thriller. This is a straight-up horror film. I mean, the performance of Mia Goth...
London Guts horror or more like psychological...
Bit of both. I mean, the best thing I could compare this to is Misery. Because the performance...
Oh, God.
Yeah. Because the performance that Mia Goth gives in this is on par with Kathy Bates. Like, it's that, like, you know, bright-eyed and really cheery and smiley, and then is, like, literally, like, chopping people up in the next scene. Like, goes from that quick.
Because X was, when that came out, it was a phenomenon, essentially, for horror fans going, this is a whole new level.
A whole new thing, because, like, what X was essentially, like, what if Boogie Nights was a horror film?
Yes.
Okay. Whereas this is very much, like, what if a Disney film was a horror film?
So, what do you give it?
4 out of 5.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay,
really, really worth the watch. Yeah, if you want something different, if you want something that's like a little bit darker, a little bit more kind of weird, Pearl is definitely one.
Ted Lasso.
Yeah, Ted Lasso season 3, yeah, is started back last night. It's not that good.
Oh, no, really? I love Ted Lasso.
I did too.
We've heard that already this morning.
Yeah. So I only watched the first episode of it so far, and I have to say it did not kind of immediately grab me the way the first and the second season did.
Oh.
You can tell, but like, this is the final season of Ted Lasso, and there was a lot of kind of production woes going through it. They had to rewrite a lot of the episodes and all the rest of it, and obviously Jason Sudeikis was going through a divorce as well with Olivia Wilde.
Yes.
And that definitely did impact the writing on this as well. I will say that as I was watching this, you could tell that everyone was, I don't want to say exhausted, but like, you can see that they've kind of run out of kind of things to do. And that makes sense because especially...
They've done that, hasn't it?
It was always just three seasons. They always knew they were just going to do 3 seasons.
I don't know if that's true.
Oh,
I think that's them kind of trying to rewrite history a little bit. Like, you can kind of... No, I do
anyway,
think...
You're only one episode in. So
one episode
listen,
in,
could
so...
still, like... It's great writing generally, and Ted Lasso, like, it's...
It is fun. I mean, I think people, like, you know, if you enjoy Ted Lasso, I'm not saying don't watch it. It's definitely worth a watch. But, I mean, I understand that it kind of doesn't pick up until, like, episode 4.
Oh,
so,
okay. Yeah. Brian Lloyd from entertainment.ie, thank you so much for joining us today.
Brian.
Really appreciate it. Now, let's check in with Alan in Kilkenny. We think Cheltenham... Has Cheltenham in Kilkenny stopped? Has he got that's a carousel?
Yes, we are telling you. We are having a great morning here in Kilkenny, and there's a real buzz here at the parade. So if you're in Kilkenny, come down and say hello. Some members of Orte here, all the way from Italy, who'll be marching in the parade tomorrow. There's lots more of them on the carousel here behind us. And after the break, we're going to be chatting to sporting royalty. Oh, Henry Shefflin and Stephanie Roach when we get the notes back. Join us after the break.
Now, Alan has been soaking up the pre-St. Patrick's Day festivities in Kilkenny all morning. It's back. Over to you, Al. How are we getting on?
Well, we're getting on great here, Tommy. Such an atmosphere here. We are in the parade here in Kilkenny, the carousel behind us, and there is a great atmosphere. And we're joined now by two sporting greats, Stephanie Roach and Henry Shefflin. Good morning to both of you. Henry, proud Kilkenny man. What a buzz here this morning. It's going to be a fantastic weekend.
Yeah, no, really looking forward to it, Alan. I think when the carousel is getting going and stuff like that, the kids will be really looking forward to it. So, it is. And I think, you know, all weekend there's a lot going on. So, really looking forward to spending some time with our family in here.
Well, we have to thank you because I know you, like, you're in the middle of training and all. And Galway beating Clare last week, how are the team feeling about it?
Yeah, well, we had two bad losses before that.
Yeah, so we needed the win.
We needed the win, yeah. So it's a little bit better, easier train last night now, to be fair. But we have a big game next weekend against Westmead, and that'll end the National League for us. So looking forward to the game, and hopefully the rain will stay away for the next couple of days.
obviously such a star when you were playing, and now as a manager, what's the difference in pressure? Is there more pressure being the manager than there was as a player?
Yeah, I think you feel more of it, Alan, because it's a collective thing. So it's a backroom team. You're representing the county of Galway and the players themselves. So, you know, you're instead of being worried about yourself and your own performance, you're worried about probably 20 performances and making sure things go right. So, yeah, it is a different kind of thing, but it's... To be fair, there's nothing like playing and the buzz you get from playing. But it's the next best thing to it, and you're still very involved in the game, which I love thoroughly.
And Stephanie, we have to say congratulations. The ladies qualifying for the World Cup. What's the buzz like now and in the build-up for it?
Yeah, it's been brilliant. It's just been great for women's football to see the team finally get there, their first ever major tournaments. I think the buzz in Hampden Park when they qualified was unbelievable. And I think everybody in the whole country now just can't wait for the tournament to come along.
And you can't, and well, like, I'm not a mad football fan, but the Lionesses last year, the excitement that created around women's football was amazing.
Yeah, I think for us, even as a nation, to watch the buzz around it, to see the crowds going into Wembley Stadium, I think there was a little bit of a jealousy from us as players not to be there, you know, at the Euros. So to now go to a major tournament and be at a World Cup and hopefully have the whole country behind us, which I'm sure we will. It's just, it's very exciting, a very exciting time for women's football.
And of course, Vera Powell, she's going to be the Grand Marshal at the Dublin Parade. I mean, she has inspired the team to get on, and she has done brilliantly.
Yeah, look, it's brilliant to see the team getting recognition. To be the Grand Marshal at the Dublin Parade is a huge thing, and I think it also makes people aware the World Cup is coming up as well. So to get the recognition of getting that, I think, shows the success of the team and the success of Vera has brought.
Now, football and dancing, we wouldn't have put together. But of course, you were in Dancing with the Stars this season. How was that?
Yeah, it was different. Very, very different than I've ever done before. But an experience in itself. It was a challenge, you know. I think, as Henry said, as a sports person, you like to have that challenge. You like to go out on the pitch and play. But to go and put dancing shoes on was totally different. And it was an amazing experience.
And you've injured yourself, but you're back. Because everyone is back this weekend, aren't they,
for
the final?
Yeah, we have the final of Dance with the Stars on Sunday evening. So all the couples that have gone before are coming back to do a big group dance. So it's exciting to get back with everybody and also to watch the final and hopefully see who wins.
Now, I know it's unfair, but who do you want to win?
It's a tough one. I think, honestly, I think from the start, Brooke probably would have been the one that I thought was unbelievable. But I think Suzanne has been brilliant. And I think when you see the progression of Carl and Damien as well, they've all been really great and they all deserve to be there. So political answer, I don't know who's going to win.
Now, from GAA and football to golfing, Henry, I remember Tommy down with you last year.
There was a few takes on that, but I'd say to Tommy, to be honest with you, because I bet him every other putt, but the live one, to be fair, Tommy acted very well under pressure. Yeah.
This is down at Mount Juliet, so tell us about it.
Yeah, so obviously myself and Stephanie are ambassadors for Mount Juliet Estate and Golf Academy as well. So I suppose we'd love to be still playing, we're not. So the rest and relaxation very much comes into it. And that's what you experience when you go into the gates of Mount Juliet. Very close to me at home. And it's just a unique experience the minute we go in for family and for myself individually. So it's brilliant. So obviously Matt over there has been trying to lesson me in golf. He's not doing very well now, to be honest.
Because we did see your golfing skills last year with Tommy.
Well, I hope you're not showing that again. But we played a bit with Tommy last year. Yeah. It was good fun, I must say, good fun. And
so tell us about the academy then. Anybody can go along?
Yeah, anyone can go along, and especially for people like myself. And I don't know, Steffi, what you're like, but it's probably trying to learn and improve, and that's where Matt and the club very much come in. And there's lots of lessons there that I keep getting, which is a bad sign for me, Alan. But and then just to get out on the course itself, it's just it's a fabulous few hours and just a beautiful location, obviously.
And you're only joining now,
I've just got onto them, so Matt better turn me into a great golfer.
Is it something that you wanted to do, is golfing? Do you actually go out then, if you're not doing the academy, would you go out? Is people find it so relaxing and it's the way to chill?
Yeah, I suppose a lot of us have busy lives and, you know, I think to go out and just, especially in the summer, I used to love going in the evening times, 5-6 o'clock, even on your own, to hit around for a few holes or go out with some of your friends. It's a very social event, and it's competitive, whatever level you're at, obviously with the handicap system. So it's very enjoyable, and it's just the time, really.
And what are you going to, what do you think now? What's your handicap?
They haven't given me a handicap yet.
We're not that far along there. But you're looking forward to doing it.
Yeah, definitely. I've always had a keen interest in golf. Obviously, with playing, it can be hard to get the time to do it. So I'm just looking forward to learning proper techniques. And the technology they have in Mount Juliet is unbelievable as well. So they'll be able to give us quite a bit of feedback on how to improve. So I'm looking forward to getting going.
Now, a big weekend in store festivities-wise. Any plans for it?
No, for me, we're doing a bit of training tomorrow, so I think...
Oh, God, the training. Will you get to do anything after the training?
No, definitely. We're going to train early in the morning so that everyone has Patrick's Day off to themselves. So, so myself and Deirdre and the kids, I'm sure, will head in. And I don't think you'll see me on this thing behind me. But
is it like that because, like, the train, you have to get the training in, obviously. A big match again this weekend.
It is. That is important. But as well as that, it's important to spend time with your family. That's number one for us. So we make sure that happens. So the lads will have tomorrow off to themselves and stuff like that. And we look forward to the game on Sunday then.
And what about yourself?
Yeah, we've training in the morning as well. But
we
have a little mini celebrity in the family. So my niece Leah is going to be in the Bray Parade. So we're heading out there to watch her on
that. Is she going to be in parade?
She's so excited.
So if you're in Bray, get out and see it. So and Stephanie's going to be there. Now, we are here and we were talking about the Mount Juliet Golf Academy. So we're going to have a little putting challenge. Matt is here.
No pressure, Matt.
Ladies first, Stephanie. You can go first. What is it, just to get near, just to try and get a hole in one?
Yeah. So we're going closest to the hole, is it?
Closest to the hole, okay, I think. Okay. That's the idea. We just do one each.
We haven't had any practice,
Are we right back here? Okay. In your own time. Look at this. Look at the concentration on this.
Oh.
I'm happy with that. That's the best one yet.
There you go. Okay, Henry, in you go. I'll take that ball back. There. Look at these sports people. Okay.
Right. I didn't eat my breakfast this morning.
You didn't eat your breakfast.
And come here, you've been doing this since last year. You're not a very good ambassador now for Mount Juliet, are you? Okay, here we go. Let's try this. When you see, this will end up the top of the parade. Yeah. Oh,
not bad.
I think me and Stephanie got there. Well, listen, lads, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks.
Enjoy
for having
the us. The weekend. As I said, there is a great buzz around here.
Yeah.
And we're looking forward to seeing you now improving and you getting a handicap down in Mount Juliet. But thanks for joining us this morning. Back to studio.
Thanks very much, Alan. Listen, tell Henry, it shows I absolutely whooped him in the pudding challenge last year.
Tommy was right up to the screen looking at that. He's staring at it going, oh, Henry's going to miss.
Easy to see why. there was no editing involved at all. Thanks very much, Henry, Stephanie, and of course, Alan.
How many times?
I absolutely nailed it.
No, I know you did live, but you didn't nail it before.
It only matters what happens live.
Oh, it only matters.
The camera's shooting. It doesn't always happen like that, as we know. Coming up, we're going to be heading back to the southeast for a special performance of an Irish classic from TikTok sensation and Kilkenny native Robert Grace.
It looks fantastic there. They're having a great morning. Yeah. We'll see you back here very soon.
Carousel's flying.
Yeah.
Very welcome back. All morning, Alan has, well, he's been spinning around carousels.
Yes.
He's been playing golf pretty badly and generally having a great time in good old Kilkenny.
You don't think he's going to be taking up the golf then? That we're going to have a pure sporty Alan Hughes when he comes back?
To beat Henry Shefflin at anything, that's a win.
That is definitely a win. Now he's treating us to some music. Alan, you're all over the place this morning.
All over the shop here in Kilkenny, but we've had great fun here this morning and the rain has held off for us. Hopefully for the next few minutes anyway. And I'm here with singer-songwriter Robert Grace, who hails from Kilkenny. And he is now a TikTok star with over 2 million views on his TikTok platform. But before we talk to him, let's have a look at one of Robert's viral videos, Fake Fine. Have a look at this. Bad luck if you're someone like me. Got your head above water, but you still can't even breathe. It's a pandemic, it's a disease. Good morning to you, Robert. Thank you for joining us here in Kilkenny this morning.
Yeah, thank you very much for having me.
Now, we're looking at your video there, and a lot of your songs, and you're very open about this, you write about your own experiences. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, I mean, I think Fake Fine was the first song I wrote where I was kind of, you know, honest. It was a song about me and not just a kind of made-up story, you know, and I think that's why it kind of connected with so many people, and I think it's kind of the reason it did so well is that I was, you know, being honest and not just trying to...
And honest about?
Yeah, honest about, you know, going through, like, hard time mentally and... Because, I mean, at the time, I suppose a lot of people were, like, during the lockdown and everything like that was at the very beginning. And so I think a lot of people were finding it hard. And so the song just kind of... It was the right time, you know, and it just connected with so many people. And, I mean, I think before that, I never really talked about, you know, how I was actually doing myself, and I still find it very hard to talk about how I'm feeling, but that's where music comes in, and it's a very good therapy for me.
And a lot of people will say that they find music very therapeutic about opening up about mental issues.
Yeah, and I think I'm lucky that I can use it as, you know, a way of getting out what I'm feeling and actually putting it into words, and then in return hopefully helping other people to feel better as well.
So. And you said like it was that song Fake Fine that sort of opened up this whole platform for you, but 2.4 million followers on TikTok, that's huge.
Yeah, it's...
How do you feel about that?
It's hard to comprehend that many people, but they're kind of spread all across the world as well, so it's mad. It's kind of crazy to try and think about. And
do people send you messages saying thank you for your lyrics and because it's helped me and that's where it's growing?
Yeah, that's it. Like, I mean, all the time I get messages from people saying, like, thank you for, you know, this song or whatever song it is and that it helped me through a really hard time. And it's hard to believe that they're real people, you know. It's kind of, because it's all online, it feels like nearly like a game you're playing rather than real life, you know. But it's, still trying to wrap my head around it.
And then, of course, you're going to be taking your music on tour as well. You're going to be starting, you're doing a tour in Germany because you're signed to a record label in Germany.
Yeah.
How did that come about, not Ireland and in Germany?
It's I got signed during lockdown. And I didn't leave the house, so...
And a record company signed you. So they obviously saw your songs and your videos.
Yeah. So they saw Fake Fine and just kind of saw the potential. And then there was a few labels that got interested and we just kind of went with the one that we thought would be the best option. And you know, just sitting in my underwear on the computer, you know, on Zoom,
yeah,
finalizing the deal. So yeah, it was mad. It was a very weird time, but yeah, delighted with it.
Now, and of course, you're in a good place at the moment, which is good. And I know your wife and your kids are going to be going to the parade tomorrow in Greignamana.
Yeah.
Now, Edward Hayden's doing the Grand Marshal here. Yeah. But you'll be supporting the one in Greignamana where he should be.
Yeah, I'll be heading down with the family and just taking it easy. I won't be playing much music tomorrow. And I'll be listening to some music, but I'll be taking it handy, enjoying a bit of family time and enjoying the parade.
Well, do you know what? You'll probably be Grand Marshal of the Greignamana Parade next year.
I was last year.
Oh, were you last year? Were you?
Yeah.
Oh, well.
You didn't get me back. No, it was great. It was great. My son Lincoln walked.
That's so lovely. Now, you're going to sing for us. We're going to let you get ready. And while he's getting ready, we're going to throw back to studio.
Thanks very much, Alan. Tell you what, everybody has been a Grand Marshal, haven't they?
Ali Fermat, will you ring Alan Hughes now and let him be Grand Marshal at some stage?
Looking forward to hearing Robert's performance very shortly. Coming up on tomorrow's St. Patrick's Day special, we're going to meet the stars of the Dublin Parade. Bobby Ewing, also known as Patrick Duffy, and the World Cup-bound Republic of Ireland manager, Vera Powell.
C'est la vie, because our favourite Irish dancing 90s Colleens are back. Bewitched are going to be checking in.
Plus, on the menu, we've got a traditional bacon and cabbage. Katia gets an Irish dancing lesson from the stars of Riverdance.
Join Elaine Martin and Katia for Ireland AM, as usual, from 7 a.m. tomorrow.
Let's get back down to Alan.
Yes, thank you very much, Tommy. We've had an absolutely fantastic morning here in Kilkenny. Thanks to everybody who's helped us out across the morning. And there's hundreds of people here in the parade now. But we're going to leave you with the Cranberries, Dreams and Robert.
Oh, my life is changing every day, every possible way. And all my dreams, it's never quite as it seems. It's never quite as it seems. I know I felt like this before. Now I'm feeling it even more, because it came from you. Impossible to ignore, impossible to ignore. And they'll come true, impossible not to do, impossible not to do. And now I tell you openly, you have my heart, so don't hurt me. Standing and so kind, you're everything to me.